Good morning and welcome to the 32nd meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2023. Today we have apologies from Mark Ruskell, and we are joined by Bob Dorris, who is our new committee member. Bob, welcome officially to the meeting. We're very pleased to have you here. And we have to therefore move on to, as a new member, to the first item on the agenda, which is declaration of interest. Bob, do you have any interests you'd like to declare?
Gunnar, first of all, thank you. It's a pleasure to be a new member of this committee. As usual, I'll draw everyone to my register of interest, but I don't believe there's anything particularly on that that's relevant to the workings and proceedings of this committee.
Thank you very much. And remind members that any item comes up, if they wish to declare an interest, they may of course do so. Agenda item two is a decision on taking business in private. We have consideration of whether to take items 7 and 8 in private. Item 7 is to consider the evidence heard on the Circular Economy Bill, and item 8 is our work programme. Are we agreed to take these in private? Yes. We are agreed. Thank you. Our next item of business is consideration of a draft statutory instrument, the Parking Prohibitions Enforcement and Accounts Scotland Regulations 2023. For this session, I'm pleased to welcome the Minister for Transport, Fiona Hyslop. She is joined by government officials Elsie McIntyre, the Principal Legal Officer for Scottish Government Legal Directorate, and Fred O'Hara, the Head of Road Policy Transport Scotland. Thank you for joining us today. The instrument is laid under an affirmative procedure, which means it cannot come into force unless the Parliament approves it. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider a motion for the committee to recommend the instrument to be approved. I remind everyone that officials can speak during this item, but not during the debate that follows. I would now invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement. Minister.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for inviting me to provide evidence on the Parking Prohibitions Enforcements and Accounts Scotland Regulations 2023. Now, as you're aware, the Transport Scotland Act 2019 prohibits pavement parking, double parking and parking at drop curbs, and provides for penalty charges to apply where these are contravened. To support this, the regulations laid in Parliament last month provide local authorities with a procedure to follow when enforcing the parking prohibitions. This will enable them to issue penalty charge notices to those in contravention of these prohibitions of £100, reducing to £50 if paid within 14 days. This brings to a conclusion a significant package of work which was progressed following the passage of the Act, including regulations brought into force in December 2022, which gave local authorities a procedure to follow to exempt areas of footway in their area from the pavement parking prohibitions. We've also progressed commencement regulations to bring the relevant provisions of the Act into force. Passing these regulations will be the final part in enabling these important parking prohibitions to come effectively into operation. As part of the development of these regulations, a public consultation was carried out earlier this year with almost 500 responses received from a mix of individuals, local authorities and community councils. The feedback from this consultation showed that the public are overwhelmingly in support of these regulations to improve accessibility on our roads and pavements. My officials have been working closely with local authorities across Scotland to assist them in preparing for the regulations coming into force. The input received was vital in shaping the regulations that are now under discussion. In addition, my officials will continue to work closely with local authorities in COSLA to identify what further funding will be required to facilitate the implementation of these regulations and to provide support to authorities in setting up back office functions in order to effectively enforce these regulations. These regulations and subsequent parking standard guidance, which will go hand in hand with the regulations, are needed to provide local authorities with a procedure to follow when enforcing the parking prohibitions and in line with the powers provided in the 2019 Act. It also sets out the procedures to be followed in relation to the appeals process and lays out the circumstances where a penalty charge notice may be appealed. The regulations also lay out the procedures to be followed in respect of the keeping of accounts and the purposes for which any financial surplus can be used. It is important to stress that inconsiderate obstructive or dangerous parking can and does cause serious problems for everyone and puts the safety of pedestrians and other motorists in jeopardy. The parking prohibitions are aimed at promoting, supporting and advancing the rights of pavement users to ensure that our pavements and roads are accessible for all. Transport Scotland will also be launching an awareness campaign in the coming days to ensure the public are aware of these new regulations and that local authorities will have the power to issue and enforce penalty charge notices from the 11th of December should these regulations be approved by Parliament. The campaign will be focused on changing the behaviour of drivers who park inconsiderately and raise awareness of the impact that this can have on all pavement users. And so I'm happy to answer any questions the committee may have on the content of the regulations.
Thank you very much, Minister. I think having followed the Transport Scotland Act through the REC Committee and also at Stage 1 and 2 and also within the Parliament, it's probably one of the most contentious issues, but where agreement was reached on pavement parking, but it was refining the details. So I'll just drill into some of the details, if I may, Minister. I think within the bill there's the ability for ministers to give directions on exemptions to councils. Have you issued such directions, and do you think they're sufficient?
Well, I'm aware, and as the committee will know, I was deputy convener at the time that this committee studied the exemptions regulations as they passed through this parliament. And clearly some local authorities will have identified, and many are still in the process of identifying the roads that they want to have exempted. So in terms of that engagement, that's an ongoing engagement with my officials and different local authorities. But it's up to the local authorities to identify which of their roads they want to be exempted.
So how far down the line have you issued any exemptions, or do you think there's enough time between now and December for you to issue the exemptions that are needed?
It's an ongoing relationship. I think it's really important this is done in a cooperative way between central government and obviously local authorities. So that engagement continues, and I think it's been done in a very cooperative way, but perhaps Fred O'Hara could maybe give an indication of that level of engagement, but I'd prefer not to be issuing directions if that's what the invitation is. It's better it's done in cooperation.
No, I think my understanding is local authorities can request exemptions in certain areas. Yeah. I'm asking if any local authorities have requested exemptions whether you have indicated you will accede to them.
Yeah, so they're in the process of doing that. So some will have done and some won't as yet, but they are in the process of doing that. But perhaps Fred O'Hara can give you more information of that actual engagement.
Yeah, I'm quite happy to come in on that. Basically, the exemptions were in front of the committee last year, so the exemption procedures are now through and in Parliament statute. The ministerial directions for those at that time were issued back in December last year, so that was basically the guidelines of where a local authority could potentially exempt a street. We are in discussions with Cosler and Scots to look at how many exemptions are actually being brought in. The actual process of that is for the local authorities to follow, and they've been doing that, and we've actively tried to figure out how many are coming through, but that's basically still in the process. We're actually issuing a questionnaire later this week to all local authorities to help kind of guide that and find out exactly where each one of them is and how many they're potentially bringing in. So we're trying to get that information more out of the local authorities as we go forward.
It just strikes me time is marching on, and unless you have an exemption, if you don't have an exemption, you're not exempt. So the areas where problems and bottlenecks might fall within the legislation.
Yeah, and that is for the local authorities to ascertain where those are. Okay. We did fully fund the exemption order procedure process back 2 years ago now. We issued £2.4 million worth of funding for the local authorities to go and look at the streets they think they need to exempt, and some are further forward than others on that, and we are pushing to make sure that they use the funding we've already given them to go and actually assess the streets and be in a position to go there.
Okay. Sorry, just cracking on with a few questions that I've got. There are slots on pavements where you're allowed, bays where you're allowed to park on pavements, and there are some exemptions to allow you to do that. Are you happy that these are sufficiently regulated to make sure that they don't multiply or they're not lost?
I think that would be a common sense approach by a local authority to determine in their own local area if they have such bays or in terms of what they need. I think it's really important to understand that this is, you know, what you've got in front of you is the regulations for the kind of enforcement and the penalties, etc. In terms of how they and the degree to which they enforce, and also in terms of how they treat the exemptions as opposed to the areas that are already designated for parking, will be a matter for local authorities to establish themselves in their own local area.
Okay, so this then is a technical question. The fine is issued to the person who owns the vehicle. They may not be the operator of the vehicle that gets the parking ticket. Is there an ability to pass the fine on to the person who is operating the vehicle, or is it up for the operator of the vehicle to pay the fine and try and get the money back?
Can I maybe just ask Elise to come in on this?
Certainly. The fine or the penalty charge is payable by the registered keeper of the vehicle, except in certain defined circumstances which are set out in the regulations, such as, for example, where the person, the registered keeper, has sold or transferred the vehicle before the time when the contravention occurred, then it would be the person who was the keeper or was in charge of the vehicle at that time. There's various other possibilities. For example, if it's a hire car, the registered keeper would be the hire company. Sorry, I'm going into
I'm happy that I understand if you hire a car that you're responsible for it, but, you know, there are a lot of situations where, I don't know, within families, maybe the registered keeper are the parents or it is their child that's racking up the fines, but the parents are the one that's going to cop it, and you're happy with that.
Well, I think that's a normal practice for these things.
Oh, is it?
And I think there is, registered keeper, I think that's a kind of responsibility for fines. And I think there is issue in awareness. I mean, we're obviously going to do a public awareness to everybody, but I think if you're in a family in that situation, I think I would be telling my children not to pavement park anyway, because it's the right, they shouldn't be pavement parking anyway, but I don't want them to make me liable for fines.
Okay, and the final question I've got, and I know other committee members have got, in some loading bays, for very good reason, there are dropped curbs to allow people to move stuff from lorries up onto pavements. I think I understand it that if it's not being used or it's not designated for wheelchair users, that it won't be caught under this legislation. It'd be helpful just to have clarity that is the case.
I think that's correct. If it's a dropped curb that's outside of a commercial premises or a residential premises, then that wouldn't be caught by the prohibition.
Okay, thank you. I think there's some questions. Monica, did you have a question that you wanted to ask?
Yeah, thanks, Convener, and good morning, Minister and colleagues. I think, Convener, you've touched on some of the questions I had just around that work to survey the streets and see which ones should be exempt. And I think it was Fred O'Hara who said £2.4 million of funding had been allocated already to local government. So I think it would be good to maybe get more detail after today's session about how that money has been used over the past 2 years to resource this exercise and to get an update on which streets, if any, will be exempt. It was just a further question I had around I suppose, attitude to enforcement. So I appreciate it is very much for the local authorities to carry out enforcement. But I just wonder if the Minister does have a view on the approach that should be taken. We obviously know what the procedures are, but some might call it intelligence-led, but sometimes there is a lot of discretion, which leads to a lot of variation. Just to give an example, my office has been asked to look at enforcement around engine idling. So we did some FOIs on that, and we found that most local authorities take a non-enforcement approach, and it's about trying to identify teachable moments to educate. Does the Minister anticipate that councils would take a similar approach when it comes to pavement parking, or will it be a more robust approach?
So a number of things, and I think the committee itself looked at the clean air enforcement issues more generally, and that was a reflection that obviously local authorities would use their discretion, but sometimes in some circumstances have taken a stronger enforcement line when they're trying to kind of persuade people to understand that. So clearly local authorities have powers in this area, and normally the government gets criticised for being overzealous in telling local authorities what to do. I think there's an issue here where we have to respect local authorities, know their communities, know their towns, know their areas, and the level of enforcement that they would want to take. So therefore, you know, in terms of the discretion they have, they do have their own discretion to what extent that they will do their, carry out that enforcement. We're giving them the powers to enable that, and by using the penalties, that obviously is a, we hope, a diversionary implement. However, I think your point about teachable moments, if that's a phrase you're using, I think is really important, because there are many behaviours with cars that we know over many years, you know, whether it's in wearing seatbelts, whether it's drunk driving, as to what's acceptable or not acceptable. I think, and I think we all know this, that in recent years, coming through the pandemic, people have, you know, walked their streets more, they own their places more, they want to be able to do that in, you know, in comfort. And I think there's a recognition, and all of us have probably been in that situation, you know, those of us who have children, and I was reflecting that, you know, I had two in a double buggy, and, you know, the most frustrating thing is you're forcing women, by and large, with young children, onto streets if you're pavement parking. So there is something around that behaviour side of things. We say, look, actually, do you know, this isn't acceptable. Why don't we just agree that we don't do that? I think there is a behavioural aspect, which is why there's going to be a marketing campaign to try and do that in a persuadable way. But in terms of the enforcement, obviously local authorities have got the tools, they've got the legislation, they've now got the opportunity to use penalty notices as well. And so we're providing the, I suppose, the tools if they want to use the stick. But actually, I think at that point about why don't we just as a country say, look, let's stop pavement parking and allow people to use the pavements with freedom. And whether you're using a guide dog, whether you're using a wheelchair, whether you're, you know, an elderly person, you're walking dogs in narrow spaces, whether it's parents or grandparents with buggies, etc. Let's just let people use the pavements.
Thank you. And Minister, you talked in your opening remarks about the public support for the legislation and the aims of reducing the impact of pavement parking on people. Just, you also mentioned that it's important that in terms of the back office functions that there is proper resource so that there can be effective enforcement. Are you able to give an update on what the sort of funding picture is for this?
We've got some estimates, but we're working with Scots, you know, all the kind of transportation officers and local authorities as to what they think they'll need, etc. And obviously that's part of that kind of ongoing discussion that we're having both with COSLA and with local authorities.
Thank you.
Right, there's a whole heap of questions. Douglas Lumsden, followed by Bob Dorris.
Thank you, Kevin. I just wanted to remind the committee that my register of interest, which shows I was a councillor at the start of this term. In terms of inconsiderate parking, I think we all agree, and the situation you described of, you know, buggies and wheelchairs trying to get down the pavement, I think we're all sort of behind. And there's other areas that, you know, I'd like to see in terms of hedges, overgrown pavements, that I think need to be tackled as well. But sticking to the pavement parking, I can think of some streets in some of our bigger cities where you might have tenements down either side. The road is quite narrow, so there is people park on the pavement to ensure that there is still space down the middle of the road. Now, I guess if you live in one of those just now, come the 11th of December, you know, you could be getting a ticket every day. So is there somewhere where residents just now can go and see whether the council's considering them to be an exemption zone in their street? Or is there a process that residents can follow to try and lobby the council to make their street being an exemption, as long as the pavement is obviously wide enough to cope with wheelchairs and buggies, etc.?
So back in last year, when the committee was looking at the exemptions process and the regulations, that was a process to enable local authorities to identify, and a part of that will have been the consultation they'll have themselves. I can't, I don't know what happened in each and every one of the 32 local authorities, but that would be to identify streets where there might be some issues. My understanding is that they also got the kind of they would be able to advertise if that was eligible for pavement parking or not. in terms of that process. And so that's what they're in the, some of them have done it, some of them are in the process of doing it. But again, it's that they will need to take that common sense view as to what's practical or not. At the same time, as you're saying, is how do we make sure that our streets are...
Because I am just concerned that, we're not that far away from the 11th of December. You know, where can residents... Because obviously we don't know how many applications there's been for exemptions. So how do residents know whether they're still going to be able to park outside the house in a month's time?
I'll bring Fred in if he can give us the information, but the sensible thing would be for local authorities on their own websites to identify that and to publicise that. But there's also a process that they'll want to go through their own committees about how they're going to enforce this. And we know, for example, that in Edinburgh that discussion has just started taking place. They think they'll be the first, but it might not. There might be a period of time before local authorities themselves know that they are ready to make sure that they are going to enforce the penalties that we are providing them the powers to do, or should the committee and the Parliament agree?
Basically the local authority have the powers to put these in, but if they've put an enforcement, if they've put one of those through, they basically need to sign in line where you're allowed to park on the pavement. So it is a national ban unless one of those signing lines are on the pavement outside your house. It's for the local authorities to advertise that process, and that's what was in front of the committee last time. So the exemption order process is there for them to follow. It includes advertising, it includes putting it on their website. They can put it in the local press if they wish as well. It's very, very similar to the TRO process that already exists for WL lines, etc. So it's there. So any local authority's website should have the list of exemption orders that they're already putting through, and any potential ones as well.
But have you seen any of those? That, I think back to the convener's original...
Yeah, there is some on certain local authorities. We have seen some movement from Dundee, Inverclyde, etc. have things up and running, and they're looking at what they need to put in. I've not seen any that have actually completed or are on the ground yet, but that's certainly with the way they're all going, and most of the local authorities are following through with that as well.
So would you expect local authorities to maybe have a bit of leeway to start maybe issuing tickets that are not going to be enforced potentially, just to make people aware that they can't carry on with the behaviours that they've already been doing until maybe there's an exemption order in place, or whether they can ask for an exemption order?
Yeah, well, we've actually been through the process with the local authorities about talking about how they handle this in the initial period. Some of them are going out with a kind of soft launch campaign where they're going to put leaflets on windscreens as opposed to tickets, etc. And that's really the way they're looking at raising awareness first. And then once they've got their exemption orders in place, they will start ticketing.
OK. And Minister, you said there's still quite a lot of work to be done in the background in terms of, I think it was some admin things. Is that all going to be done before the 11th of December?
Well, that's up to local authorities again in terms of their own processes, what they'll need to do that. Some are more ahead than others, but in terms of we are providing the powers for them to carry out the enforcement using penalty notices if they choose to do that. That's up to them to be able to work out what is the level of enforcement. You can see some local authorities quite clearly might want to take a heavier hand sooner than later, but I think the more common sense point of view is the point that's just been illustrated by giving people notice in some shape or form to raise the awareness, saying, look, this is coming in now, so whether it's leaflets or whatever in the relevant streets.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, Bob.
Thank you, Convener. I know I've just declared my interest in none to declare, Convener, but as I was listening to the questions, I thought perhaps, although it's not formally declarable, I am patron of Glasgow Access Panel, who are based in my constituency in Maryhill, and there's a kind of crossover in relation to some of the work, so not declarable, but I thought for transparency I would put that on the record. So a couple of questions. My first question, Minister, is in relation to the education campaign, the awareness campaign. I think most people accept that pavement parking is pretty much inconsiderate. Drivers know what they're doing, but they're a bit inconsiderate. We have to change that culture. But I think sometimes around drop curbs, drivers are often oblivious to it. It's an unintended consequence due to not willful ignorance, but just a lack of awareness. Will the education campaign take that on board? Because I think there's a bit of a difference in relation to where drivers are in relation to those things.
Well, I was very keen to bring forward the Martin campaign, because although there was a lot of awareness at the time, for example, when Sandra White started her private members bill, which was then adopted by the government that then went into the Transport Act, that act was passed at the end of 2019. And although actually the the ban on that type of parking, whether it's in double, the double parking or indeed drop curb or indeed pavement parking, was brought in 2019. Obviously, some time has passed, so I think that's why it's going to be really important to remind people, saying actually that's what the parliament passed in 2019, but actually what's happening now is the delivery, the operation, the final elements to bringing us into force by providing the enforcement and the penalty notices process. So I think there is something about awareness, because that's some passage of time, and I think there's a duty and responsibility for all of us to help that, to make sure that people are aware of that, because I suspect people might not be, and although they might be aware of the pavement parking, they might not necessarily be aware of the drop curb issue. And I think that's probably a challenge, because I think you're saying you might not be cited for drop curbs, and I suppose that's an issue again for local authorities and our enforcement officers to identify, actually, is that a reasonable or unreasonable, what's a common sense approach to what's happened in that situation.
Thank you, Minister. Ask a little bit about enforcement and the guidance in relation to enforcement. Glasgow City Council, certainly in my constituency, they're actually very good. I have a constituency with wheelchairs, mobility scooters, who have no access to local services, and they'll have that direct conversation with their lived experience, and they'll put drop curbs in to allow them to go about their lives. However, in relation to enforcement, where there's breaches from drivers in relation to that, I get that enforcement has to be intelligence-led, it has to be practical, it has to be cost-effective, and that might lead to enforcement in areas where there's other enforcements already taking place in relation to driver breaches, where there's clusters of potential breaches, and it might not be in our local communities where those in a mobility scooter or a wheelchair just have their life devastated by not being able to cross the road, or have a constituent who will do almost a 1 mile alternative route previously because of breaches of drop curbs. So what guidance is there for local authorities that they shouldn't just focus their enforcement where there's clusters of potential breaches or where it's cost effective to do enforcement, but also to enforcing those individual breaches which could be absolutely devastating to the lives of those with those mobility issues?
So I think that's a really important point. And again, it's a decision by local authorities, but I think they should be informed by local communities. And I think that continuous dialogue that is helping inform the guidance, which will come out in terms of the parking standards guidance, will come out at the same time as we're obviously commencing these, should Parliament agree them in terms of the vote of this committee and also in the Parliament. I think in terms of that responsibility to identify individuals, individual councillors no doubt will be approached by individuals that will have individual circumstances. They can obviously actively take that up with the local authority to ask and request that. Similarly, MSPs no doubt will probably get contacted similarly. And I think local authorities are increasingly having the type of access panels that you're talking about. And we obviously, as a government, obviously consult with the mobility access committees and in terms of their advice. So that would be proper and responsible community engagement, and obviously any individual issue, that's something that I'm sure with representation can be delivered, but I can't make local authorities do that. They have to do that themselves.
But is there, sorry, Cabinet Minister, that's all positive, and I absolutely get that. I've got sympathy for local authorities, convener on tight budgets, and enforcement have to be practical and realistic in relation to where that enforcement is going to take place. But is there guidance around this in terms of making sure they don't only focus on, it's not profitable, but areas where they can get the largest amount of income and make the biggest impact in terms of enforcing breaches vis-a-vis individual cases such as I'm highlighting, where enforcement may make a much bigger impact in changing the quality of people's lives?
Well, the guidance is currently being prepared and finalised. I think Mr. Dorris has made a very good point, and I'm sure officials can, if it's not already shaping in the guidance, that's something that we could consider to put into the guidance, because I think it's a very well point. It's not, you have mass impact, or do you have quality of life for one individual? And I think both are important.
Thank you.
Thank you. And now to the Deputy Convener, Ben.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister.
Good morning.
Panel. First of all, I just want to say how welcome it is that these regulations are being brought forward to implement these important aspects in the 2019 Act. And quite understandably, during the process of the 2019 Act, the balance between the needs of business and small business in terms of deliveries and unloading was considered. And exemptions were made in Section 55, subsection 6, to allow, in reasonable circumstances, for pavement parking to happen as long as there was 1.5 metres at the edge of the pavement, and that the parking didn't take place for more than 20 minutes. Unfortunately, what happens in my constituency and others in urban Scotland is that deliveries take place in a way that is not unreasonable, and there's not adequate space left at the side, and it does happen for longer than 20 minutes. So in terms of helping to create that cultural change, because we don't want to necessarily punish people, we want to change attitudes and practices, as the Minister has said. So as part of that, in terms of the delivery of the enforcement of these regulations, as well as a public marketing campaign, will there be significant engagement with the business organisations and the large supermarkets, the prominent delivery companies like Parcel Force or DPT or UPS, you name it, there's a long list, because I think it will be important to inform those drivers that there's change coming.
So the answer in terms of that engagement, that's been continuous with particularly key and delivery companies in particular. That's been part of the process of drawing this up, and in terms of that engagement that's required. In terms of the marketing and the communications, obviously the marketing will be a general one, but in terms of the communications, clearly that's something that can be done on a national basis, and in terms of that engagement, I'm keen that that does take place. But I would also expect local authorities in the local areas, with their local chamber of commerce or their particular streets that they know that they're going to want to enforce this, and to have that active engagement with businesses at a local level as well. But I can reassure you that in terms of that ongoing issue, that's part of awareness, is to make sure that drivers are aware. It was something we were just reflecting on, that although some delivery vans are obviously branded and white vans and we know who they are, that increasing deliveries are in people's own vehicles, but it is for a business purpose. So therefore, as long as they're abiding by the regulations referred to by the member, then that wouldn't be subject to a penalty notice if they were abiding by that.
Thank you.
Okay, I think that's all the questions. Quite a lengthy list this morning, so we'll move on to the next agenda item, which is a debate on the motion calling for the committee to recommend approval of the draft Parking Prohibitions Enforcement and Accounts Scotland Regulations 2023. Minister, would you like to speak to the motion or move it, or just move it?
I'm just happy to move the motion.
Thank you very much. Are there any contributions that members would like to make? Monica.
Thank you. Not a contribution, but given the nature of what's just been discussed, I should refer to my register of interests, the voluntary section, as I am patron of Disability Equality Scotland, just to be transparent on that.
Okay, noted. Does anyone else have any other comments? Okay, Minister, this could be a very brief question. Can I ask you to sum up and respond to the debate?
Could I thank the committee for both the questions and their contributions, and I hope their support for this important final part of these regulations.
Thank you. The question, therefore, to the committee now is motion S6M10704 in the name of Fiona Hislop be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The committee will report on the outcome of this instrument in due course, and I'd like to invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to finalise the report for publication. Are we all agreed? You're looking nervous, Jackie, about that, or are you happy?
Yeah, I'm delighted.
Thank you very much. Thank you, and thank you, Minister, for you and your officials for attending, and I briefly suspend the meeting. Thank you. Okay, welcome back. Our next item of business is an evidence session with the Environment Advocacy Groups as part of our Stage 1 scrutiny of the Circular Economy Scotland Bill. I'm very pleased to welcome Phoebe Cochrane from Sustainable Economics Officer for Scottish Environmental Link, Michael Cook, the Chief Executive Officer from Circular Communities Scotland, James McKenzie, the Circular Economy Advisor, Action to Protect Rural Scotland, and Kim Pratt, the Circular Economy Campaigner, Friends of the Earth. Thank you for joining us today, and thank you for submitting your evidence to the committee's call to view. I'd also like to welcome Murdo Fraser, who is joining us for a specific item within the Circularity Bill. Now, we've allowed up to about 75 minutes for this item, and we're going to move straight on to questions from the committee. And I'm going to kick it off with a very easy one, if I may, and I'll give each member of the panel a chance to answer it. You won't always get a chance to answer every question, but the first one's an easy one. Really just to ask whether you think a circular economy strategy would be useful as part of the bill and should have been part of the bill rather than something that's produced a bit later on. James, do you want to start off with that?
Thank you, Convener. We do, of course, support there being a circular economy strategy. It isn't clear to us why this should be a statutory requirement when ministers could, after all, just make their own strategy. However, the bill as drafted and potentially as amended would potentially enhance the way Parliament could scrutinise ministers, see how they're being, how they're living up to their objectives. I think it would be more useful if it had an explicit purpose in the bill. I'm thinking of, for example, the aims in the National Parks Act or other legislation. This bill doesn't do that, so it has regard to various elements of the circular economy, but it doesn't have that kind of core purpose in it, which I think would help inform the strategy and other policies within the bill.
Thank you. Michael.
Thank you, Convener. We support the provisions in the bill relating to a strategy. Stating the obvious, it's better to have a strategy than not have a strategy. Having it in the legislation will set the frequency. It has the potential to say you've got to take into account other forms of legislation. I agree with what James said around a purpose. I think we would like to see a bit more clarity around what we're trying to achieve through that strategy and in what timeframes. So things like a top-down approach to the waste hierarchy, valuing the environmental and social impacts that the circular economy can deliver would be things we'd like to be explicitly stated, but supportive of a strategy.
Okay, Phoebe.
Oh, thank you. Yes, we support a strategy in legislation. I mean, after all, we've had a strategy since 2016 and a lot of it has not been delivered on. So with it being in legislation and the reporting requirements that go along with it, we think it makes it much stronger. We would like an additional thing. We think the strategy should be linked to the delivery of the targets once those have been set, which, as it's written at the moment, that's not included.
Okay, and Kim.
So the first thing I'd like to say is generally we welcome this bill and our comments here today are about making it as robust as possible. Yes, we do also support the strategy being included in the bill. We would like to suggest that the Climate Change Act is a useful template for the framework that we should be looking for the Circular Economy Bill. So that includes a strategy, the Climate Change Plan, and that strategy is quantified, it's linked to the targets, and it sets out plans for each sector. And that's what we need for the Circular Economy Bill as well.
Okay, so thank you for that. That's useful. I mean, some parliamentarians, and I put myself in this bracket, are very nervous about bills when they are framework bills, which allow a lot of things to be agreed post the bill coming into force, which in my mind does not allow full parliamentary scrutiny. Are you concerned like I am, or are you happy that it's a framework bill and the meat will come later? I'm going to start in the middle and work out. So, Michael, you're just about in the middle.
I think framework legislation has its place, but that by itself, it's like a chair with one leg. It's not stable. You need to be clear not only what powers you're creating, but how they're going to be used, what might be the unintended consequences of those powers. So I think in this case, with this bill, the waste route map is another leg to that chair, and I think that should really be seen alongside the bill. So what is in the waste route map if we have the power to create charges? What would we plan to use those charges for, in what products, and how? What might be the unintended consequences of that? The devil's always in the detail. So we are supportive of the powers in the bill, but very keen to know how they're going to be used, like you would be.
Okay, James. Oh, sorry, I'm just throwing it around so you're not all predicting where you're going to go next, James.
That's absolutely fine, Convener. Happy to put on the spot. In general terms, kind of broader than this legislation, I do share your concerns about the extensive reliance on framework legislation. I think there's a middle position where there's more detail, a more detailed framework, parameters for how ministers should use powers under secondary legislation under it. I think, and obviously it reduces scrutiny. By the time an SI comes to this committee, you can't amend it. It's only up or down. You're relying on the government's consultation process primarily. From our perspective, the framework ought to be broader. So I'm going to, for the first time, start talking about producer responsibility. There's nothing in the framework on producer responsibility, which for us we think should be the core of the bill.
Okay. Back to the middle, Phoebe.
I think in these circumstances, we do support a framework bill for an issue like the circular economy, like climate change, which is really sort of multifaceted. It needs to operate at all levels and all sectors. And also it's fast changing, so there are new innovations and new policy developments coming through all the time. And without keeping that sort of that option of a broad scope approach, you know, I think those you'd come across sort of hurdles that needed more legislation down the line.
Okay, and Kim, you predicted you're next.
Yes, so yes, I agree, we do need framework legislation for creating a circular economy. What we need to do is completely change the way that we use materials in our system, and to create those system-wide changes, we need a strong, clear framework to lead us on that path. Again, I think that the Climate Change Act can be a useful guide for this, and there are kind of four main elements we see as being needed in the framework for the Circular Economy Bill that are drawn from the Climate Change Act that was supported by this Parliament. So we would like to see consumption reduction targets that are set in the primary legislation of the bill. They should be science-based and they should be legally binding. We need a strategy. We need monitoring and reporting that is specified in the bill itself rather than by ministers, and should include a new independent body to monitor progress. And then we also need just transition principles as well, which at the moment are completely missing from the bill.
Okay, so mixed messages of support, I think, is where I'm at there. We've got some more questions. Monica, you're next.
Yeah, thank you, Convener, and good morning to our panel. Kim, you've gone straight into targets, which I wanted to ask about, but already have heard about the link between the strategy and the targets and what they might be. So I'll maybe skip past Kim and come back to you. But Phoebe, maybe you can go first by just saying a little bit more about what circular economy targets you would like to see introduced, and if you're satisfied with the framework the bill provides for setting these targets. And also the committee would be interested to hear any international examples that are relevant here in relation to consumption-based targets.
I mean, it's a difficult area, the targets. You know, I won't pretend it's not. But we definitely need consumption-based targets. I mean, that's the sort of the backdrop to the urgency of this legislation and our climate and biodiversity crises, that our material consumption is the sort of the key driver and increasingly recognised as such. So we need targets that relate to the quantity of materials we're consuming and the environmental impact of that consumption. And you know, we've proposed that there are targets introduced on our carbon footprint and our material footprint. And we recognise that there will be arguments against those targets in terms of the reliability of data, but especially for the carbon footprint, it's something we already report on. And we've been reporting on for some time, but there's been no target associated with it. And we've been publishing the material footprint for a couple of years now. The data on that is improving, so that could also be used for setting a target. The Dutch government, you know, they introduced material footprint targets a good few years ago. They were one of the first governments to do so. The European Parliament have approved footprint targets. And various other jurisdictions have footprint targets, Flanders and I'm struggling now, I've got somewhere in my notes, but probably Kim will jump in with other examples. So, I mean, that's looking at sort of overall footprints. I mean, I think, you know, on the other end, the sort of residual waste per capita is a useful target for which we definitely have data, and that's easy. Looking at the most harmful sort of most carbon intensive materials or goods, you know, food waste is a target that should be in legislation, and increased ambition on that. Food waste is really one of the key areas that can have the biggest impact both on biodiversity and climate in terms of a more circularity. So I think probably let others.
No, that's really helpful, and can come back to Kim. I'll go along the table. So, Michael, you're next.
Yeah. I think targets have their place. I mean, we've talked so far about strategy and targets. Mm-hmm. Put simply, targets, where do we want to go? Strategy, how are we going to get there? I think in the case of targets without, in this case, systems change are targets that we will miss. And I will point to the current recycling targets as an example of that. You know, we had a target of 60% by 2020, and we're currently at 43.3% for last year. So targets have their place, but on their own, you won't hit them. So the one target we would love to see, and we do support Friends of the Earth's call for a consumption target, but one thing I think is missing here is reuse targets. We have a lot of focus in the bill and indeed in current targets on recycling, but reuse is a lot better for the environment and for people than recycling. So just for clarity, you know, a laptop, if I recycle it, I'm recycling the plastic, the glass, the metal. If I reuse it, it's remaining a laptop. If it's broken, I fix it. And it's so much better for jobs. It's so much better for the environment. So we believe that slight technicality here, but a preparation for reuse target. So what percentage of material presented at household waste recycling centres, local authority sites, goes for reuse over other forms of, you know, be it landfill, incineration or recycling, would be a huge strength to this bill, because at the moment reuse is a second class citizen to recycling in terms of how money is spent and in terms of how facilities are orientated towards the behaviours that come afterwards. And in terms of international examples of that, Flanders have implemented a reuse target. Instead of doing it in an abstract way, they have actually related it to head of population, so it's expressed as kilograms of reuse per person living in an area. So it makes a city comparable to a rural area, for example. And that has undoubtedly driven up levels of reuse, which has in turn created jobs and made it more convenient and easy for the public to do more reuse, and you have a sort of virtuous circle there.
Thank you, Michael. And if there is a perception just now that reuse is a second-class citizen, to use your words, compared to recycling, in terms of the waste hierarchy, are you nervous that this bill might miss that opportunity to redress that balance? Because there is a lot of discussion about the recycling part of the bill. Mm-hmm. Are you nervous that reuse is not given the prominence that it perhaps
absolutely
needs?
Yeah. So, I mean, if you imagine a ladder as the waste hierarchy, the bottom rungs of that ladder are landfill, incineration and recycling. The top rungs of that ladder are reuse, repair and tackling consumption, so reduction of consumption. And this bill has a huge amount about recycling, it has a lot about litter, it has a lot about fly tipping. All of those initiatives, I think, are good and well-intended, and we would support. But it's really taking our feet off the ground and the bottom few rungs of the ladder, and we really should be focusing on the top and where we need to be. Zero Waste Scotland's report last year on the circularity gap said Scotland is currently 1.3% circular. And the problem with bottom-up policies, you have a landfill ban, it dries up incineration capacity. You have an incineration review, and we tackle that, and then we start moving on to recycling. We have a target for net zero in 2045. There's not time to take the waste hierarchy one ladder at a time and, in effect, building capacity for the next level and then decide actually want to move to the level beyond that. So a clear signal to industry, to local authorities, that we are moving to a reuse and repair economy where we make products last. That was the name of the 2016 strategy that Phoebe referred to. Of course, if something can't be reused, recycle it. Mm-hmm. But if it can be, that's what we should be doing.
That's really helpful. And James?
Yes, so I draw a distinction between targets that government sets for the kind of country as a whole, whether or not they have the measures underneath them, and targets that government can set on individual producers or retailers or sectors. So completely endorse what Michael is saying about focusing on the top of the waste hierarchy. This, in many respects, is a bill that focuses on litter, waste and recycling rather than that top end. But there are really good examples happening right now around Europe where there are requirements on producers to build in reuse requirements. So in 2020, Austria passed legislation that said there must be binding and enforceable reuse target of 25% by 2025. Portuguese law said 30% of all packaging on the market of any material must be reusable by 2030. So these aren't, you know, a government target is an ambition. So you look at, there's an ambition in the climate change plan. There's an ambition in here to be a circular. But these are requirements in the same way that there were requirements within the deposit return legislation that said you must get this kind of return rate. So those really drive action. Those tell businesses we need to start shifting away from single use, this kind of linear economy where we just, it's not even a race to the bottom. The race is finished and we're like almost at the bottom right now. So there are plenty of examples like that. And we would rather see, I know everyone's talked about different sorts of targets, and I apologise for a kind of target fest, but targets from our perspective that would be very important would be those on producers, producer responsibility. And I would really recommend to you a paper that was produced, published very recently by Zero Waste Scotland and others, the title of which briefly escapes me, about recovery, which focuses on another one of those, which is a target on the reduction in the use of virgin materials. So that is kind of a market measure. It uses commercial pressure to say, okay, well, you can achieve this any way you want. If you can achieve it through reduction and lightweighting, that's great. If you can achieve it through reuse, as Michael's talking about, that's great. Refillables, that's fine. But then you set those targets on industry. They have to meet, and then it's up to them to innovate how to do it. And those are binding. A target on a government is never binding, as we've regrettably found out in a number of other policy areas.
Okay, thank you. Probably need to try and get through the next couple of questions really quickly, but that was really helpful. I'll come to you, Kim, and if you've got anything briefly to add to that first discussion. But are you satisfied that you'll have the opportunity to engage in the detail of target setting and scrutiny of proposals via secondary legislation, which is set out in the bill, what that process might be?
We feel that we do need targets to guide the scale and pace of change, and that those should actually be set in the primary legislation of the bill. So the goal of a circular economy is to make the consumption of our materials more sustainable. So the targets must reflect that. And at the moment, Scotland measures the impact of its consumption in two ways. It measures it through its material use and the carbon impacts of its material use. So these are sometimes called our material footprint and our carbon footprint. And we would like to see our carbon footprint being used as the primary driver for a circular economy. That's because we have better understanding of carbon. We've been measuring it longer than material use. And also, it would stop this problem of carbon leakage that we have with our existing climate targets, which focus on reducing our emissions within Scotland, which is important to do, but that is only part of the impact that Scotland has. And in fact, 58% of Scotland's carbon footprint comes from our imports, so that's not currently being included in our climate targets. So what we would like to see is the consumption, the carbon consumption targets within the circular economy bill being used alongside our existing climate targets, and the two used together to make sure that Scotland's progress towards a more sustainable future is effective as possible. And to do that, they need to be in the same units, greenhouse gas emissions. They both need to have the same goal, net zero by 2045, and they need to have the same, be set at the same legislative level in primary legislation, so that one isn't seen as more important than the other.
Thank you. And Phoebe, in terms of that opportunity to engage in the process?
I can't quite remember what the provisions in the bill were in terms of, but I think there was going to be a consultation on the targets as it sets, am I right? Yeah. So I think we would feel that that was adequate if there was stakeholder engagement and a normal consultation in terms of developing the targets.
Thank you. Any other views on that point? Okay, well, I've got one more question, Convener. The bill provides that Scottish ministers may set targets. So are our panel satisfied that this goes far enough? And in the context of the climate and nature emergency, what should the timeframe be for setting the targets, and should that also be reflected in the bill? I don't know who wants to go first. Kim?
Yes. So we would like to see mandatory targets within the primary framework of the bill. And the reason for that is that we know that Scotland's consumption impacts already are extremely serious and extensive. So Friends of the Earth Scotland published a report earlier on this year called Unearthing Injustice, which looked at Scotland's supply chains for certain materials, and it found extensive environmental and social impacts right across Scotland's supply chains. So that doesn't align with Scotland's goals and aims. So, for example, our National Performance Framework goals includes an economic outcome that our economy is ecologically accountable as well as socially responsible. So at the moment, that is not the case with the way that we use materials. We need to change the whole system to make that happen. And I would say one other thing on this as well is that the way that we don't account for materials in our policy making at the moment is a risk to the success of those policies. And I think the energy strategy is a particularly important example of this, where when the energy strategy consultation was published earlier on this year, there was no plan for how we would obtain the materials that are needed to transform our energy systems, despite the fact that some of those materials are rare and difficult to obtain. And that is a risk to the success of those plans.
Thank you. Any further contributions on that question?
I think must would make more sense than may. I agree with Kim. This is an urgent situation we're in. I'm going to quote, if I may, very briefly from the Zero Waste Scotland paper that I talked about. They said, it's a UNEP reference, a circular economy allows us to end our war on the planet without giving up the benefits of modern life, which seems like quite a good objective to me and something that we should really expedite.
Okay, so mandatory targets.
Yeah, and the correct targets and the action plan. Actually, one little footnote, if it's all right, to say that the bill is being considered at the same time as a future vision for the circular economy is being developed, and doing them both at the same time seems rather peculiar. I could see doing the vision first and then the primary powers to deliver it, or the primary powers and then the vision for how you use it, but then we're slightly held back by that process.
Thank you.
Sorry, yeah, I'm going to bring you in, Phoebe. Just because the official record only notes what you've said, not the nods. I'm just so I get this right. You all appeared to nod when it said must rather than may. Is that right?
Yes.
Yeah. Yep. So you believe it must rather than it may. I think that's clearer for the record. And some questions from the deputy convener next, Ben.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. We've heard from yourselves about recycling and reuse today, but I just wondered what your thoughts were on opportunities that there are to redistribute unsold goods rather than dispose of them, and what initiatives are there already here in Scotland to build on that? Anything you'd like to cite for our awareness? Michael, if
you'd like I'm happy to come in on that. So we strongly support, let's go that far, the proposed powers around restrictions on the disposal of unsold consumer goods. There's been stories in the media, that talk about examples of perfectly good goods not being used once and going to incineration or recycling. I think the limits in the bill as proposed that we would like to see improved is an acknowledgement of the waste hierarchy. So reusing a product for its original purpose is better than recycling. I think maximising the social impact is also an opportunity. If it can be donated to a charity, if it can be redistributed to help the economically disadvantaged. And I think the third thing would be keeping it local, not export. There is a clothing mountain in the Atacama Desert visible from space. We don't want to add to that. I think when we talk reuse here, these products haven't actually been used once in many cases, so it's not even reuse, it's just use. But the simple truth is that a product that has been created has carbon embodied within it. It took carbon to run the factory where it was made. It took carbon to extract the materials to put into that product. It took carbon to bring that product to here. So whilst there would be certain exemptions, health and safety, medical, things with the best before date, we do believe that perfectly good products should have a useful life, and that useful life should be maximised. So sending a clear signal to private sector that we can't just destroy these things because it has a brand to protect or whatever would be worth doing. I think also, just to take a couple of words from the bill, one consumer, that suggests end of supply chain. What about further up the supply chain? And durable goods, what are unsold consumer goods? What about food and food waste? So one of our members is Fair Share, and they obviously do a lot around food waste already, but a simple stat from them is that food that is fit for human consumption, that is eaten, is 17 times better for the environment than food that goes to animal feed. We shouldn't have food poverty and food waste. So everything around a food waste target would support that, but also around, the destruction of goods. Could that include food? Could it include food further up the waste hierarchy? Just to say, this is being done in Europe. France passed a bill in 2016 specifically on food waste. Spain has passed legislation relating to durable goods being destroyed, and it has seen greater levels of reuse and all the environmental and social benefits from that.
For me, that was very interesting. And just building on that, Michael Cook, so at the moment, the relationships, whether it's food providers to Fair Share or mm-hmm. big retail companies to community third sector organisations, I mean, that happens in my constituency. You talked about legislation being a key part of, and obviously that we're looking at a bill here, but as the practical implementation of the circular economy, is there more that the state should be doing to connect these organisations to produce that flow through in order to make sure that the utilisation of product takes place rather than waste?
I don't think policymakers can get into the warehouse and start, you know, the innovation that needs to follow from a clear statement that you can't destroy these goods. Hopefully the market would follow the right nudge there.
So that encouraging through legislation and otherwise.
So, yeah, I mean, I think
the private sector, but the private sector needs to step up here effectively, is what you're saying as well.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, these companies, internet retailers, for example, they're fantastic at logistics. They do that so well. But, you know, this just requires that same skill set applied to the priority of reducing waste and maximising the social and environmental benefit of those goods. So I think the key thing missing from the bill, in my view, would be stating that it's the waste hierarchy and it's local over international that should be, and social benefit as well as environmental. I think there are three protections that would avoid the unintended consequences. So, I mean, the one unintended consequence we would want to be avoid is if there is a retailer and they already have a partnership with a local charity and they're giving goods to them, that this requirement to do it at scale that they might not have been doing it at suddenly creates a big sort of private sector industry, and that charitable enterprise and the local benefits of that gets swept away. And there has been example that with EPR legislation in France, for example, that happened. It used to be done at a small scale, and in the desire to do it more for the planet, which is good, the people got the social benefits of that got lost, and we would want to avoid that. So three provisos: the waste hierarchy, social impact, and don't export to get around the problem.
Okay. So, and be cognizant of unintended consequences.
Yeah. Everything can have unintended consequences in such a complicated economy. When you're bringing in more circular practices, you've got to be clear. It's a balance that's needed.
Thank you. I think James McKenzie was looking to come in.
Just a very brief one, Deputy Convener. So I completely endorse everything that Michael says. It's quite extraordinary to find a way to make something worse than make, use, dispose. Just literally make and dispose. I mean, it's a sort of iconic moment of corporate bad behaviour, in my view. The one thing I would say, as I say, completely support all this, but this is a relatively small problem. It's sort of totemically awful. But the policy memorandum says, on an estimate based on per capita figures from France, it's £22 million. Pounds worth of goods. So that should not be happening, and I support this in the bill. But that is a little less than 0.07% of the Scottish economy. So it's good that it's in there, but let's not overestimate the difference it's going to make.
Thank you. Did any of the other panels here? Phoebe Crockley, you want to come in?
Thank you. I think we definitely support this element of the bill. It does place a responsibility on producers and retailers and does have the potential to actually change business practice. You know, at its best, it could change the way that producers and retailers, the type of goods they produce and manufacture, if they have to deal with returned goods, they want that good to have some value. So that could affect, you know, their choice of how goods are manufactured, the goods they produce and sell. There's an interesting paper, a recent paper, which does a series of interviews with retailers about this problem. And it also talks about the sort of, they call it the downstream side of it. So that problem of actually passing those goods on. And it talks about third sector organisations like the members of Michael's organisation, but also talked about how there are cases where quite sort of big enterprises have developed sort of with a purpose to refurbishing and managing these goods. And this, you know, as an example of, you know, a more sort of potentially, you know, potentially that's needed. Or so what would be even better was if the organisations and businesses that have produced those goods, if they could alter their own supply chains, you know, incorporate those goods back into their supply chain, then that is the best outcome. And combined with the reporting requirements, it works well together, because you need the reporting requirements and other measure in the bill to identify where these surpluses are, to raise awareness about them, to inform where to apply these restrictions. And that's one of the, I read, that's one of the aspects that isn't included in France in the ban, which means that has been less effective there.
Okay, thank you. And Kim Pratt, you're also wishing to
answer. Thank you. So we also support this element of the bill, and I agree with what my colleagues have said already. And I would make one further point in that extended producer responsibility could be used to hold businesses to account more to pay for the cost of the cleanup of their products, and that could be included in the bill as well.
Can I ask, in terms of doing that in a just here in Scotland, obviously the many producers are operating internationally, so that, do you have any further points around that challenge of legislating in one place but actually producers having a wider operation?
Yes, so we have the powers to do this through the 2021 Environment Act, so it's within Scotland powers to do this, and I think there's a similar issue with other types of environmental progressive policies, is that it can have wider impacts, and that bringing in those larger corporations that act outside of Scotland is something that we want to do at the moment. Though the profits being made by these large corporations are not staying in Scotland, and that money could be used to fund a circular economy. That's why extended producer responsibility is so important. This is the way that we fund a circular economy in Scotland. It's disappointing not to see more extended producer responsibility opportunities being taken within the circular economy bill.
Okay. I think we could talk a lot about that particular point, but I think we should move on, Convener.
Well, just before we move on, if we may, maybe a chance to develop it, is the opportunity to redistribute unsold goods. I understand that there is already an element to that, but if goods that are unsold in Scotland, say in a company that operates across the United Kingdom, surely the answer is just to pop it on a lorry and send it south of the border to be used down there, or where there aren't that legislation. Do you think, you know, we need to work lockstep together across the United Kingdom to make sure that this works properly? You know, can Scotland go it alone on this, or does the United Kingdom have to work together on it? Because I can see that happening. Maybe I'm seeing bears behind trees, but would anyone else want to make a comment? James, do you want to say anything?
Convener, I think in general terms, if there's progressive and sensible environmental policy being developed in Scotland and it is in line with what is being developed in the rest of the UK, that's beneficial. You know, when we looked at the deposit return system, perfectly capable for Scotland to go by itself, but compatible systems, not in every detail, are beneficial. In terms of the relevance to unsold goods, I suspect, given the scale of the problem, it's not going to be worth large distributors changing their distribution habits to stock from Newcastle or Carlisle rather than the central belt. But
I wasn't suggesting that. I was suggesting if it was unsold in Scotland, it's very easy to put them on a lorry and put them into a warehouse, say, in England. Rather than changing the stocking system.
Yeah, and Michael said, the closer the better, and the next closest place from distribution or being given away in Scotland is obviously over the border in England. Yeah. Just with reference to the question about producers elsewhere, which the Deputy Convener asked just very briefly, the normal proxy is to use importers, where you can't directly regulate the producers when stuff is coming into the country.
Sorry, just say that again. I missed that.
So if you're trying to bring in producer responsibility and you're looking at large international supply chains, then, again, as with the deposit system, the importer is treated effectively as a producer.
That's putting a border onto Scotland if there's a different UK legislation?
It's a strong way of putting it. We regulate it. We regulate for Scotland, and that would be you regulate for Scotland, and that would be the way of doing that.
Yeah, Michael.
I mean, I think backing the potential unintended consequences you mentioned, I think, are real. But I think there are some things that would mitigate against them. So I think one is the requirement for waste reporting, and I think allowing, therefore, scrutiny of what you're doing with your waste. And, you know, at the end of the day, a story of redistributing goods to hard-up households in Scotland is better than trying to get around environmental legislation for a retailer or a wholesaler. I think another one is just the idea that what this is trying to achieve for people and planet is a good thing. Waste is not a good thing. And it doesn't... I actually think one response to it might be that we manage our supply chains better so we don't create surplus stock, which is actually an alignment between what the environment would ask for and what actually is the profit motive for the producer. So it might create a more efficient industry.
And with the greatest respect, Michael, if we could all make sure that our stock perfectly matched demand and you had the ability to do that, you'd be in very huge demand with some of the big multinational companies. But it's not always possible.
Yeah, I'm not saying totally, but yeah. More.
Okay, I take the point. Bob, you've got some questions, I think.
Just a couple. I mean, I think most of them, the deputy conveners, kind of worked through the kind of questions I was going to ask. I suppose it's just an opportunity to put anything additional on the record, because effectively I think we are talking about we need different business models, particularly from large manufacturers and large retailers, not just within Scotland, but in an international basis, rather than just the take, make, dispose economy. And I'm conscious the word used isn't always part of that either, given what we've been talking about. Do you want to say any more about the business models that are really damaging our environment and the circular economy? Or what would be more constructive would be what other business models are out there that are developing that this bill could incentivise or drive if we could make it stronger? So an opportunity to maybe put some of that on the record, but I think everything else, convener, the deputy convener's kind of covered most of it.
If you will look at where it means I have to nominate somebody, and that's always a dangerous thing. James, thank you for putting your hand up.
I was inviting you to nominate, but I'm happy to speak.
No. I'm nominating you.
Oh, that's fine. it's the core question of what this bill should be about, and thank you for asking it. From our perspective, as I've said earlier, the priority, and others have mentioned, the way to change that is products remain the responsibility of producers even when they pass through your hands, right? So that is how you close the loop. At the moment, we have an economic system which says, okay, there's two companies competing with each other. One of them brings their used products back in and refurbs them, puts them back on the market. It's a costly process. The other externalises their costs onto the environment, onto local taxpayers, onto society, maybe blame the public for littering it. But as soon as you require people to close that loop, as soon as they can't externalise their costs onto us, climate terms, waste terms, biodiversity loss, costs to local authorities, then you start to build a circular economy. And this is something which Scottish Government talked about in 2016, Making Things Last, that others have talked about. It's a good document. Said, we intend to explore the concept of a single framework for producer responsibility, bringing together common elements into one flexible and transparent system, making it simpler for businesses who are involved in more than one product type, and making it easier to add new materials and products to the producer responsibility regime. That's what I would like this bill to do. And that is how you close the loop. That is how you encourage, that's how you give an economic advantage to the companies that handle their products better, that design them better, that capture them more efficiently, that lightweight them, that make them easier to reuse, or reduce the demand for them in the first place. So that for me is how, that's the absolute core of environmental economics and the circular economy, is all producers should be responsible for their products at end of life, and all fillers should be responsible for their packaging, unless you've got a really good use case for why that doesn't work. And that will take time in some sectors. It needs to be considered with delicacy. You need to talk to industry, you need to work out what can be done when. Without that principle, we're going to stick with a 1.3% circular economy.
Hey, Kim. Thank you.
So I'd like to mention one element that businesses will need to incorporate as we transition towards a circular economy, and that's making sure that we do that in a just way. So at the moment, there's no mention of a just transition in the circular economy bill, despite the fact that we acknowledge in Scotland that to create the future that we want, we will need to do that in a way that incorporates people in that decision. In order to do that, the bill has to include three elements of a just transition. So firstly, we have to think about the way that we support people to transition into more circular jobs. And we could be using the just transition principles within the Climate Change Act as a starting point for those principles. And then we also have to think about the way that communities have to change their materials and make sure that they're involved and supported through that change. I'm thinking particularly of groups like people with disabilities and ethnic minority groups who might have language barriers, for example. So we need to do that. And then also, of course, we need to be thinking about our supply chains, which are extremely unjust at the moment. So we need to be thinking about how we can support a global just transition as well. And we can do that by embedding just transition principles within the circular economy bill.
Okay. Mrs. Green. I'm going to widen your question, if you don't mind, from just a business model to actually the system, which I think both my co-witnesses have done too. So the fear I would have is that this bill will do a lot in favour of recycling, but no more than that. And I've said that before. And I just want to make the point of give some real tangible examples of that. So SEPA list 177 local waste and recycling centres. The language we use there, you know, the fact that they're waste and recycling, not resource and reuse, but I'll move beyond that quickly. We know of four of them, four out of 177, that have a co-located reuse facility there. Why not all of them? Greece has passed legislation that says any town with more than 50,000 people in it should have a local authority reuse facility. That can be in partnership with the charity. They don't have to run it. But there has to be one in a town of that size. The benefits of it, job creation. I'm a member of Reuse, the European body for reuse. For every 10,000 tonnes of waste that goes to landfill, creates six jobs. To incineration, one job. To recycling, 36 jobs. Great, let's recycle. Hang on. For reuse, up to 296 jobs. Depending on the material stream, IT, for example, being higher than textiles. So it's an opportunity to create jobs. Those jobs are more skilled. It takes more skill to repair a broken laptop than to strip it down. I think we can just think that through ourselves and how we would go about doing it. I wouldn't be able to repair one. I could break it up. It has social impact. So the Charity Retail Association for the UK published a report just a couple of weeks ago saying that for every pound invested in charity reuse, charity retail, your local charity shop, you get £7.35 return on that investment for social impact in that area. And so that's all on the social side. It's good for people. It's obviously good for planet. It is terrible for the environment to build a product, never use it once, or only use it once, and then because it's got a broken something, not repair it, not reuse it, keep it being used as that product. So in terms of the whole system that we have, it is geared towards recycling. We're not getting spectacular levels of recycling. 43% doesn't compare well with Wales, for example. I think the best way to turbo that change is to actually have a top-down approach. And I know some of you are concerned about fly-tipping, Mr. Fraser there, here for that. But, you know, actually one of the reasons we have fly-tipping is because we have actions at the bottom of the waste hierarchy, sticks more than carrots, a landfill tax, for example. And the way around that is to not do the right thing with that resource and take it to the local authority site. It's to throw it into a beauty spot. So, you know, a top-down approach to the waste hierarchy actually helps with litter and fly-tipping too, because we change our relationship with stuff. We see them as reusable, refillable, and that item has more value.
Okay, thank you.
Yep, sorry, have you finished one?
No, that's fine.
Oh, sorry, okay, yes, Ben, sorry.
Just a small question related to that. I think you make some very impactful points there, Mr. Cook, but is an also important point is, you know, accessibility of a facility. So, you know, a council recycling site is sometimes only really able to be reached in a motor vehicle. So as we consider this process, do we need to think harder and more imaginatively about how there are reuse facilities in the high streets and towns and cities of Scotland? Because, you know, if you take a laptop, for example, in my constituency of Edinburgh, Northern Leith, there's the Remakery, and they are doing remarkable work on laptops. But if, say, for example, an iron broke, I wouldn't have, and my constituents wouldn't have an idea, I don't think, where to take that to get it repaired rather than buy a new one. I'm just using that as an example. You could think of many. So do we, you know, could the charity shop network provide innovative possibilities here in terms of retail units that are already in prominent locations?
I mean, I totally agree with the premise behind your question. My reason for wanting reuse facilities at HWRC sites is because I visit
them. Sorry, I wasn't arguing against that, just for clarity.
I visit them and I see perfectly good things being thrown away, and they shouldn't be. But that doesn't mean that from a consumer point of view, we don't want to make it more convenient. And that could be a shop local to them. It could be a collection service. It could, you know, curbside collections. It works for some goods. For me, we need to just change how we think about waste, think about it as a resource, and make it, you know, what will change behaviours is we go to fines and bans quite quickly, but actually the 80% mainstream middle would respond to it being easier, it being more convenient, it being more attractive, the hours of opening being when they need. But all of that requires investment. So charity shops can't do that on their own. And the very valid point that James made, that at the moment, the reuse operation is competing with an internet retailer being able to get you a new one tomorrow at a very cheap cost. And sometimes that's because the costs have been externalized on people in the supply chain or on the environment, either in the manufacture of that good or in the end-of-life treatment of that good. And we all pay the cost through, you know, our council tax for paying for the waste to be treated with. So we need to level the playing field and therefore say, you know, the cost of a product on the environment and on people should be the price of the product that you pay at the counter, which means producer responsibility. It means a charge for the waste. But we would love to see that money used not to perpetrate a system of subsidise the recycling, but to facilitate reuse, to facilitate repair. In Austria, they've just passed, they created a scheme for repair vouchers. Any member of the public can go into a shop local to them and say, I want this fixed or this fixed. There's no form for them to fill in as the consumer. The form is filled in by the shop, who then fix that item. And they set a budget for 400,000 items to be repaired by 2026. They have already repaired 560,000 items. So the demand for it has been high. Wow. Now, you may say, well, that means the cost is high. But the advantage of that scheme is you only pay when it's used. You don't pay anyway, you pay when it's used. And if that was paid for out of EPR fees, the people that are putting the products that get broken that need repairing, it could fund itself.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks for that. Douglas, I think you're next with some questions.
Thanks, Convener. I was going to move on to charges for single-use items. So what are the key environmental opportunities of the proposed powers for charges on single-use items, and how should charges be incorporated strategically in Scotland? Anybody want to pick that up?
First part of your question.
Yeah, what are the key environmental opportunities of the proposed powers for charges of single-use items?
I can start if you like.
Yes, yeah, of course. Yeah.
So I think it's been shown that charges can be effective in influencing consumer behaviour for single-use items, and you know, the aim should be to reduce the consumption of those single-use items. So where there is a clear alternative option for consumers, the charge can be useful in doing that.
And I know it's been mainly thought about in connection with the single-use beverage cups, for example, and there's been quite a lot of work on that. And I think trials have shown that a charge alone would possibly reduce consumption by about 20%. So this is where, really, to be very effective, you need parallel mechanisms to also encourage consumers to use alternative cups. So we think that definitely there's absolutely no place for single-use items in closed-loop settings, so restaurants, sitting cafes, hotels, even airports, festivals, canteens, anywhere where people don't move far from the place to consume their hot drink, you know, or eat whatever they're eating. You know, you don't need single-use items in those settings. And also with cups, we think there should be sort of a deposit system for reusable cups. And I mean, ideally, if you could have that, you know, the bigger the scale, the better, because then you can drop off your cup, you know, anywhere. So, I mean, ideally it'd be Scotland-wide, but, you know, being less idealistic, or city-wide schemes. And there's quite a lot of experience of these in Germany. But they, you know, they get around the problem of if people don't carry around a reusable cup with them, then they can access a reusable cup for a small deposit and return it at numerous locations, ideally.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that, Phoebe, from your submission. You know, you talk about a national reusable scheme, and so that's been used in other areas. And would that just be like a plastic cup you get from, I was going to say, Starbucks, and then you could maybe even return to Costa or when you get your next cup?
Yeah, I mean, ideally you have an unbranded cup so that, you know, you can return it from one city in another city, for example. If you hop on the train, you know, you don't want lots of different competing reusable cup schemes, because then people are, you know, ideally you don't want people ending up with lots of different reusable cups. You want them to maybe have one at home and have access to others when they're out and about if they've forgotten theirs. But, you know, the interoperability of that scheme is really important to make it effective, because, you know, when we're thinking about the overall aim of reducing our material consumption, you know, the last thing you want is people having lots of reusable cups, because the materials in those cups is obviously considerably more than a single-use cup, and it, yeah.
And Michael, if I come on to you about the same sort of topic, instead of talking about reusable cups, you talk about in your submission about actually trying to ban all single-use items where available alternatives exist.
So I think if you think of a range of policy interventions, from a ban to a charge to a voluntary industry-led scheme, you know, basically they have a higher intervention threshold. But I think, for example, Phoebe mentioned, you know, single-use cutlery and single-use plates and things like that in a canteen environment. I think we should just ban that. I don't think we need a charge on it. I think a charge might end up being the same as a ban, but harder to influence. So, because there's really no need for that. The convenience, there isn't a justification in that environment for it. However, I think in some cases it could be. It's really clear in the charge option that you distinguish between products for which there is a readily available alternative. That the purpose then of the charge is to take what is in effect an unconscious habit on the part of the consumer, I buy a cup of coffee and it happens to come in a cardboard cup, into a conscious choice, because now there's a 20p charge or say something, and now I think, well, do I want to pay that, or do I want to pay for the reusable option? But that only works when there's an option. If there is no option, if there is no viable option, or the option is really inconvenient or really unattractive, then it is just a tax. It is just a revenue generating. So in the first example where there's an alternative, the hope of the policymaker is that actually we'll create that charge, you'll bring in some money, that will deliver systems and behaviour change, and that charge will disappear over time because no one will use that product anymore, there won't be a market for it. So one is a nudge to change consumer behaviour, the other is a tax to generate revenue. And I think where the consumer and the voter will be least enamoured to a charge is where it's claimed to be one, but it's clearly the other. So we're doing it for environmental reasons, but it seems to just be creating revenue. Does that make sense? So I think it's really clear to understand what the alternative behaviour is you want, what's the target that you set for it, and is the alternative attractive enough to deliver that change? And if it's not, you have to also invest in the alternative.
And in terms, you mentioned revenue. In terms of proceeds from any charges, where would you like that to go? You know, would you like to see it ring-fenced and used for certain things? Or
I think the carrier bag charge, which wasn't a tax, which enabled the retailer to set a worthy recipient of that, did that approach did help achieve greater buy-in to the idea, less resistance to the idea. The other point I want to make is that the end user, the consumer, it does feel like the responsibility has always been putting on them. And just to echo the point James made earlier in a different context, that actually it's the system that gives me two bad choices. Mm-hmm. And then I feel bad that I don't make the better of the two bad choices. So I do think, you know, if it was down to us, and I think we said in our submission, we don't have time to look at one product at a time, just say single-use products where there isn't a clear medical or health or a real need for them, have to be stopped use by a certain time. Go and find an alternative and just set a clear direction of travel for that. But I do think, you know, being clear that you need an alternative, a positive alternative, and it isn't just taxing the consumer. If money is coming in, it should be used to mitigate the impact, the adverse impact on planet of that bad behaviour.
Okay. James, did you? Sorry. Kim?
Yes, so I just wanted to support what my colleagues here were saying, and then also add that for cups, we do recognise that a lot of work has gone into this process so far, and we wouldn't want to see that wasted. But in general, we believe that we don't have time to change our economy one product at a time. There is an urgency to the climate crisis, and charges are sometimes not strong enough. And in the case of cups, we're talking about a product that is not recyclable, that has plastic in it, so it shouldn't be incinerated because that's releasing fossil fuels into the atmosphere, that also has cardboard in it usually, so that shouldn't be landfill because that releases methane. So we're talking about quite a harmful product, and for really harmful products, we should be thinking about bans. And in the long term, I think the biggest environmental opportunity is where we have a system where producers think carefully when they are designing products and consider whether it's worth bringing a product onto the market if it is going to be environmentally harmful.
Okay. Just to provide a little bit of balance, we had a submission from the Scottish Environment Services Association said that the use of disposable cups are visible, but in terms of waste, it only amounts to 0.036% of Scotland's total waste arising, and we should therefore... We suggest that there are other more pressing parts of the waste management system in greater need of the Scottish Environment's resource, which would have a greater impact on carbon savings. James?
What Kim said about focusing on product by product, this is an example of that, and members will remember the interest in straws. Now, yeah. Your colleague, Mr. Golden, once explained to me that if you took every straw given away or sold in Scotland the year before the ban and you melted it down, it would fill just one of the largest builder sacks. So, not nothing, mm-hmm. but that's a national usage. So, in terms of prioritisation, you know, I think this is an easy win. This can readily be done. The system, you know, even the packaging and retail sector in the Scottish Government's consultation response said, we don't think the charge is the right course of action. We prefer the introduction of a mandatory take-back obligation. So there's no reason not to do it, but we need to prioritise those things which are causing the gravest mm-hmm. and most substantial environmental harms.
So, sorry, can I just clarify? What's being suggested is things that are single-use should just be banned as a group because we don't have time to look at each and every one of them. Is that what's being suggested?
Where there's a practical alternative. So where there's a practical alternative.
Okay, so single use. Sorry, I'm just trying to follow this through so I understand it. Nappies, single use, viable alternative, cloth nappies, with people washing them. Is that something that you would like to see banned?
That's not on my list. I mean, it's...
but it's on Kim's list because she said it's the most dangerous thing, that was the most dangerous product should go because they contain plastic and microplastics.
Yes, so I think that is an example of a product that where there are viable alternatives that we should be looking towards making that the main option. So, yes, I think that we do.
I think it's quite a bold step to just make the comment that you've made, and from a legislative point of view, it would be open to some disagreements.
I think we would need to make sure that people were supported in that process of moving over to those systems. And we know with many reusable options that in the long term they are cheaper for consumers. So, and nappies is one example of that. I think, you know, we need to appreciate that there are unintended consequences for businesses of some of these changes, but up against that is the climate crisis and the emergency that we're facing right now. And we have to balance those two. And at the moment, our climate is at breaking point and we need to do something.
Kim, I understand that. I was trying to give a specific example which may cause a problem if we banned all single-use items. And I kind of regret doing it because I've opened Pandora's box and I know Monica's going to come in and I know Bob wants to come in. So Bob was first and then you, Monica.
Well, I raised my hands earlier because I did want to talk about nappies, one of my favourite subjects. So thank you for that, convener, because one of the discussions I've had with the government is about the opportunity to amend this bill to make it easier for people to transition away from single-use nappies to cloth nappies, you know, nappies that can be washed and other products like that, like period products. So the good news is there is a demand, there is a consumer demand, and I believe some local authorities who have schemes to help people access these products have waiting lists. But on a serious point, we've had really bad news this week because the trailblazing Totsbos company based in Glasgow has gone into liquidation. And that's 47 people being made redundant. But they've been really innovative in terms of, you know, reusable nappies and other products. They supply the baby box, for example, in Scotland. So that is a really serious point because there are difficult trading conditions. But are there opportunities to work with not just businesses, but nappy libraries, the third sector, to give people the awareness of these products, to access them in an affordable way or a free way? I mean, North Ayrshire, for example, has a cost-neutral scheme because the council saves money on landfill, but people in the area get reusable nappies for free for as long as they need them. So do we need to join up these activities and these conversations? Because the last thing we want to see is really responsible businesses who are innovative going bust when we should be doing more around existing supply chains and procurement. So I'll put that out for discussion.
Sorry, Monica, I'm really conscious of time, so I maybe let a couple of people come in, and then I need to go to Bob, and then I need to go to Jackie.
It was more about amending the bill. Is that an opportunity to be more proactive,
who would like to
put a duty on local authorities?
Who would like to start on that? Michael?
I mean, I think your concerns about an outright ban on all single use, I totally get that, and it's your job. It's kind of our job as environmental bodies to ask for it, and it's kind of your job to question it, and I get that. But let me maybe use some language that I think would resonate. We need a pathway to a future where we don't have single-use items when there isn't a really good reason. And at the moment, convenience is trumping the cost on the environment over and over again. So I think there are different tools in the toolbox for policymakers to use. I think a ban, charge, investment in alternative, readily, you know, making them more attractive, like what Monica has just described with nappies. But I think sending a message that we're here, we need to be here. Single use doesn't really have a future for the planet. Resources are too valuable to use one. It is the opposite of a circular economy. A single use product is the opposite of that, because a circular economy is about using resources over and over again. And when those products contain damaging materials and have pollution issues, have plastic issues, microplastic issues, it just compounds that. So I'm not an idealist and saying ban them tomorrow, but I do think we need a pathway from where we are to where we need to get to. And at the moment, nappies are a great example of this, that We are just externalising the cost. And the environmentally responsible thing to do is less attractive, less convenient, and we do need policies that change that.
Bring Bob in, and he'll then ask somebody else a question, and they can answer the point that Monica raised at the same time. Bob, do you want to come in?
Okay, it was actually inspired not by nappies, Ms Pratt, I have to say, although she's clear an interest with a 2-year-old, it'd be a significant burden on me to move to non-disposable nappies, but I'm willing to be convinced for the environment, convener. It's more about the question that the convener was making about, on a case-by-case basis, we identify straws or bags or cups, and we move at a relatively slow pace, and we do knock off one at a time. Is the need for this bill, or government more generally, to get a cluster of items that we can all agree single-use should not exist, and to legislate on a group of items rather than simply asserting all single-use items should be banned as a matter of course? Is there a better way of doing it than going one campaign at a time to a cluster of single-use items together and to try and legislate on that?
James, you look keen to come in, and then I'm going to go to Jackie.
I kind of would say that, wouldn't I? But the argument for most products, and the thing that allows you to generalise it in the way the 2016 Scottish Government paper talks about, is making producers responsible for it. So in some ways, that can negate the need for a ban or something complicated in regulation. If they're responsible for it and they have a target for how much they have to get back and they have to use it responsibly, then suddenly single use becomes uneconomic, because the cost that they're putting onto us, they're putting onto themselves. And so, you know, I feel there's a kind of socialist argument for this, that what we have currently is a system which externalises the costs and socialises the costs and privatises the profits. But there's also like an Adam Smith argument for it, which is this is the kind of system which then gives an economic benefit to those companies who are prepared to innovate and invest and reduce their carbon footprint, reduce their material usage. And so that, for me, that's the framework which, and there are complexities with, you know, I'm thinking that, you know, we're not going to get to take back requirements on period products. There are things which are not in that category. It doesn't get you out of all the complexities, but across a wide range of products and packaging, that simple framework then builds the system that delivers the kind of outcome that we need.
To Jackie, and I'll give Phoebe and Kim a chance to answer this one and the others at the same time.
Sorry, thank you. It was going back to what Michael was saying about the single-use cups being, and Phoebe as well, currently being charged 20-25p, and you were discussing about folk hiring reusable cups instead because they're more environmentally friendly. Now, for me, that would prove to be the more expensive option. So, were you thinking about maybe that single-use cups should be maybe the same price as hiring the reusable, so that folk are not getting financially penalised for trying to do the right thing? Or do you even think that single-cup buying a single-use cup, should be even more expensive than that? Phoebe.
Yeah, I can jump in. So I'm sorry if I didn't explain clearly, but the reusable cup, it would be a deposit. So there would be no outlay. You would just put a deposit for it, which you would then get back when you returned it.
Yeah. So there'd be no cost.
No net cost. Okay. No. Just for the period you're using the cup, you would.
Speaking to someone that's got about 10 reusable cups.
In the evidence that we got from SRU, I think it was, what they're doing at Murrayfield with cups there, mm-hmm. which was a useful bit. Sorry, Douglas, back to you with your question.
Yeah, thank you. My next question was on the UK Internal Market Act that you'd raised previously. And, you know, in terms of single-use coffee cups, I don't see that being an issue with the UK Internal Market Act. But when we start talking about things like nappies, for example, then there is a potential, I would think, that could be an issue. Because, you know, let's say we banned some single-use products like nappies or disposable barbecues in Scotland, then I guess people could still order online and that could be a potential issue. Would you agree with that, or do you think that's something we could overcome if we had to? And I know, James, you'd mentioned UK Internal Market Act before. So.
Yeah, no, I spent 10 years working on deposit returns, so I became kind of unduly familiar with the operation of this legislation. So it is clearly a relevant factor. If we talk about charges on single use, that is a condition on the point of sale, which is one half of the matters that are covered by the Internal Market Act and would require an exemption. In terms of how Scottish Parliament, Scottish Government should deal with the Internal Market Act, I think our view is that they should legislate to make good policy. If it requires an Internal Market Act exemption, they should seek one, and they ideally should be provided with one. I think I would probably say if there are two equally good ways of getting to the same objective and one of them requires an IMA exemption, I would recommend the one that doesn't, just for sort of expediting the process. So bans and charges are really covered by this. It very explicitly. So, you know, you see stuff around glue traps being, we talk about ban in one part of the UK and not in others. You end up where you can ban the use of something, but not the sale of it. Mm-hmm. Action to Protect Rural Scotland wrote to the Prime Minister and to other party leaders with links from across Great Britain arguing that there should be a sort of qualified automatic exemption from the Act for public health and environmental measures, because part of the premise of devolution was we would get to try and do things differently. Sometimes they would work, sometimes they wouldn't. Carry bag charge is an example of that. But this is one of the merits of a take-back requirement, which is it's not about the point of sale, so it doesn't require an IMA exemption. So most of the producer responsibility stuff that I've been arguing for today is untouched by the IMA, and so that makes it easier to act in that way.
Sorry, Kim, did you want to come in?
Yeah, so I'd just add to what James was saying there. So, Friends of the Earth Scotland believes that the Internal Markets Act must be considered when we're implementing any environmental progressive policies in Scotland in the future, but it shouldn't stop us making the legislation that we know is needed in the first place. In the past, we've seen a lot of good progress being made where one nation within the UK has taken forward an environmental policy, it's proved to be successful, and then it's been adopted throughout the rest of the UK. And we wouldn't want to stop that mechanism being able to happen. So we would like to see legislation still being made, regardless of whether there might be an Internal Market Act exemption needed or not. If we need the policy, then we should be legislating for it.
But making legislation that wouldn't actually be allowed to go through, that sounds quite a wasteful thing to do, wouldn't it?
Well, I think we would have to assume that it would go through with an IMA exemption. If we decide that we need something like a circular economy bill, then we should be making that legislation in the first place, regardless or not whether there is a potential barrier down the road.
Okay. Sorry, James.
Can I just offer one little quote in support of that? So the IMA was amended to include the common frameworks that you'll be familiar with, and the resources and waste common framework said that where EU directives set minimum standards or targets, etc., different parts of the UK have been able to set higher standards or targets where they wanted to, and often done so for waste issues. So the fact that it might require an IMA exemption doesn't mean that it won't. You know, you can't assume whether it will get one or not. You know, it requires government to take part, all governments to take part, all four, in that framework process in good faith and look at the evidence, and then ultimately persuade or not UK Secretaries of State whether to bring an exemption to the schedule of the Internal Market Act.
But it seems like we're not almost in a situation where we can ban the use of something, but maybe not the ban of sale of something, which would be, you know, in terms of nappies, would be quite a crazy situation to be in. So, but maybe we've run out of time, convener. I'm happy to leave it there.
We've got quite a lot of questions to go, and I think I maybe just move on to the next one. I'd just like to say, before we do move on to the next thing, is the committee went and visited Bing Group last week and had a very interesting visit to see what they were doing as far as recycling and moving away from landfill from where they started. And I'm going to ask a very simple question, which you can all just say yes to if you like, I'm inviting you to do so, is one of the things that we heard was there were 32 councils across Scotland with 32 different recycling schemes with bins. Some of them are the same, but some of them are different, and you could have five bins in one council, two bins in another. And the one thing we heard on that visit, that we should have a standard system across all councils in Scotland. Yes or no answer. Do you agree? James?
Yes, with caveats, Camilla.
Okay, so I'll take that. Thank you. Michael?
Yes, absolutely.
Phoebe?
I mean, yes, probably with a few caveats in that a very densely urban situation would require slight differences to a sparsely populated rural area.
And Kim?
Yes.
Thank you. I'm going to move straight on to the deputy convener with his questions and then come to, I think, Murdo Fraser. Yes, Murdo Fraser afterwards. Yeah.
Thank you, convener. A number of you mentioned considerations around waste crime earlier, and that is obviously a point of consideration within the bill and a challenge more widely for all of us. So I just wondered if you had any thoughts further to what you've said already as to what additional measures could the bill include to tackle waste crime. This will include, of course, fly tipping, but feel free to broaden any points beyond that. And I know Mr. Fraser will ask about fly tipping more specifically. And I should just state as well that fly tipping is as much of a concern in different ways in urban Scotland as it is in rural, and although I appreciate the significant challenges in rural Scotland as well. Does anyone want to make it? Mr. McKenzie?
If nobody else fancies it, I'll have another go. So ending fly tipping is essentially moving you from the absolute lowest point. You know, it's not even in the waste hierarchy. We're not dealing with it at all. We're just putting it in the sea. We're putting it in beauty spots. We're putting it around the back of Leith Walk. So it's important to do. This is definitely a worthwhile objective. However, really the priority here, the further down the chain you start, the harder it is to make change. So the point at which you're just trying to sort of police the public's activity, you've already lost the battle at that point. There may be measures that you can do that will have some effect on it, but we're within a system where it becomes cost-effective for somebody just to, say, chuck their mattress in a Perthshire Glen rather than having it reprocessed, right? So if... I know this sounds stuck record stuff, recycling records, but... if that mattress had, if there was an incentive to get that back to the manufacturers, which the industry wants, to get it reprocessed, right? The British industry wants that because they're being undercut by imports that don't do that. Just to pick one example, which I know is quite a commonplace of fly tipping, then suddenly you start to engage the higher levels of Michael's ladder up the hierarchy. So, if you're trying to just enforce it right at the bottom, you need to start above that. You need to start above the local authority level. Local authorities is picking up the detritus of a linear economy at the best of times anyway. So the further up you move it, as soon as there become incentives to take stuff back in, then why would you fly tip it if you're going to get value out of that, if it becomes part of a circular chain? So I'm not saying we shouldn't address it right at the bottom. It's a matter of serious concern to APRS, but the more effective measures are always going to be starting further up the chain. And just one example in terms of what enforcement looks like, we recently looked at data out of Highland Council, and over the last 5 years they issued just 19 fines for fly tipping. 19 of those weren't paid, and then no further action was taken on them. their enforcement across the whole of environmental fines. This is not just fly tipping. Every single environmental measure that you might get a fine for in Highland Council. 5 years ago, that was 1.7 full-time equivalent people, right, across the whole of Highlands. But this year, 0.15 FTE. So that's about 5 hours a week across an area of a third of Scotland to deal with all... So the more powers in this area, one thing, but that's the reality.
That was very interesting. So the enforcement is a point of consideration, and being more punitive is potentially a less practical solution than actually creating more opportunities for recycling, reuse, and upcycling would be have greater potential effect for change. In your view.
If you get paid £5 or £10 to hand a mattress back in somewhere, rather than having to pay to get it taken away, then you're probably not going to go to the trouble of taking it in a van in the middle of the night. But also, it is an extremely difficult crime to enforce.
Yeah.
Right? Like, the average borders bit of countryside doesn't have CCTV right by the burn, you know? So it's just about stopping it further up the chain, I think, would be the priority.
Mr. Cook, do you want to comment?
Agreement with James. I think one slight lens I would want to put on this, it's not the whole picture, but I think it contains some valuable insight, is that fly tipping is exacerbated or happens more when we have the policies at the bottom of the waste hierarchy that haven't been totally thought through, that I've referred to earlier. So I'll give an example, a landfill ban. When you start saying every ton of waste, you have to pay a certain charge on that, you have created the potential for a grey economy, which won't charge that and will instead throw it in the nearest beauty spot. So the problem is it's too much stick and not enough carrot, if you know what I mean by that. You know, where is the £10 deposit on a mattress that if actually I do the right thing? Why not even £10 and you'll collect it from my house? Make it really easy, because when do I need a new mattress? When do I need to get rid of a mattress? It's often when I buy a new one. So hand it back, you know, take back scheme. It's the same delivery driver that can pick one up and drop one off, and I get £10 off. So that carrot, if you would, instead of the stick at the bottom of the waste hierarchy, a carrot at the top. And I do think, you know, waste crime, if you lined up the whole population into quartiles of how environmentally conscious they are, for example, there are people that will go out of their way to recycle something at this end of the spectrum. They will take it to the local charity shop to donate it. They're already using reusable cups, you know, all those sorts of things. Sadly, at this end of the spectrum, there are people that will break the law, either for themselves, throw their own things away out the car window, or for other people. They'll collect goods and fly tip them. So whilst we need to deal with that, please don't forget the mainstream middle. 80% of the people in the middle want to do the right thing. If it's convenient, it's easy, it's attractive, and it's cost effective. Please focus on creating policy for them that makes it, you know, far more easier to get your mattress recycled. Give me confidence in the system that if I send these goods to the local authority site, they will be reused or recycled. That your pickup doesn't require me to put it out on the street the night before when it rains, and then it can't be reused. You know, those sorts of policies that just make it easier, more convenient for the mainstream middle, because fly tipping does even happen. You know, representing a key member interest of ours, we think about fly tipping in terms of beauty spots. What can happen is that well-intentioned members of the public want to donate to a charity shop. They turn up at the charity shop. Maybe the volunteer didn't come in that day. They're not open. So they leave the donation outside the shop, thinking it's a donation that will be used. It rains, the weather happens, and the next day, you know, when the shop is open, they come in and they have waste to deal with, which, by the way, they have to pay potentially to when it gets sent for waste, because it can't be used anymore because it's been ruined. So fly tipping happens in different ways, and, you know, it's about having incentives, not just penalising it.
I think that's an important point, and that particularly in urban Scotland, I think a lot of people perhaps fly tip unwittingly.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, I think there might be a good juncture to allow others to come in.
I'm going to bring Murdo in, but interestingly, on that trip that we had last week, we heard that it was very easy to print off a waste disposal certificate to allow you to dispose of waste, and there were no checks done online. And I would also say, and I would declare my interest as somebody who owns land, it's not the council who pays for it, it's the person whose land it's dumped on. And that can be prohibitively expensive if you get 50 tyres that are thrown out into a field or whatever. But, Murdo, I'm sure you're going to talk about that. So, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Still morning to the panel. Yes, on fly tipping, as you probably know, I ran a consultation on the Members' Bill on fly tipping, looking at a number of specific measures and attracted broad support for that. I have support to take that forward, and it's currently in the drafting process. But there are opportunities, I think, to use this bill as a vehicle to try and introduce some of these changes, which is very welcome. And the Scottish Government produced a national litter and fly tipping strategy that was published in June, which again is helpful. But just before I come on to talk about some of the detail of that, I just wanted to pick up the point Michael and James, you both made about barriers, because one thing that came really strongly out of the consultation I ran when we asked people around this, is that they said if legal routes to recycling were more easily available, that would help tackle the problem. And one thing we've seen in recent times is local councils reducing access to recycling centres. So, for example, a number in the area I represent have reduced their opening hours due to budgetary issues. Some have introduced a booking system, so you can't just turn up, you've got to book, or a queuing system. Some are closed at weekends, for example. I mean, to what extent do you think that contributes to the problem, and how can we try and tackle that? Either of you.
Or colleagues. I mean, of course, if it's made harder to do, if it's more expensive, if it's more awkward, if it can only be done while you're at work, these are all going to compound it. And again, I mean, I sympathise with local authorities here. They have tight budgets, and even when stuff does come to them, it's essentially they've got no input in what it is, how it's made. They've got no product design role. They're just left to deal with whatever has been bought, sold, and ideally used. And so that's a tough job by the time you get to the waste facilities that should be reuse and recycling facilities. And it becomes labour-intensive, it's difficult to manage. Understandable that they end up reducing their hours, but that it's definitely, your argument is correct. And sorry to say it, but if there's responsibility for the producers who made those products, then that takes the burden off both the public and the local authorities. You know, there's arguments about the costs will get passed through. We pay the costs anyway, whether it's in amenity, whether it's in resource use, whether it's in local authority staff time or cleansing time. So, yeah, it's, for me, it's about making sure that there's an incentive right from the start to get everything back in. Because if that exists, and it's somebody else, if it's not the individual responsibility, you're not left with this unmanageable item, you know, large uplifts or whatever, but somebody else has the duty to pick it up, and it's the one who made the money out of selling it, then it stimulates both the economic activity and reduces pressure at the bottom end of the hierarchy, and fly tipping is the absolute bottom.
Below the bottom.
It's below the bottom.
I would encourage the committee to invite someone like Keep Scotland Beautiful, who are obviously experts in litter and waste crime, more than us. But what I would say is, I mean, we just see it incrementally. So, for example, I don't know if the committee are aware, but there's concerns around persistent organic pollutants, POPs, forever chemicals. And understandably, for the environment, more controls are being brought in around the destruction of those. Now, one fear we would have around that is the knock-on impact that would have for fly tipping. If it's more expensive for me to dispose of my sofa or my fridge because there's more charging on that, it becomes more expensive to do the right thing, dispose of it responsibly, than to do the wrong thing. There is no booking system at the local beauty spot. You know, just go out, go at night time. You know, then it can, and it actually, from the consumer, often it isn't that they do it directly. It can often be through an intermediary. I'll pick that up. I'll clear the house. It's almost sort of small business, really. So I think it's a problem. But I would just still encourage, can we lift our eyes off the bottom of the waste hierarchy? You know, I think doing the right actions for upstream would help mitigate that. You know, James's mattress example strongly support that. Make it convenient, pick it up and recycle it.
Yes. So I think the independent review on incineration that was conducted for the government last year has some relevant points around this. In particular, it said that there was not enough national coordination of recycling services, and that is leading to an imbalance in the system. In particular, there's this overcapacity for an incineration that is pushing us towards that. Rather than more circular measures. So having that national oversight is important as well.
Okay, thank you. So if I can ask just a question about more specific items, because I in my consultation proposed four changes. Now, one of them was an enhanced duty of care on waste generators. I'm very pleased to see that's covered now by Section 10 of this bill. But there were other measures that I consulted on, and are also mentioned in the National Litter and Fly Tipping Strategy that don't actually appear in this bill. So there are three items. One is improved data collection, which is mentioned in the strategy, but there's nothing in the bill about that. The second is the point the convener has just referred to, which is the question of liability on the innocent landowner, which seems to me an inherent unfairness. And the third is the question of penalties. So at present, the fixed penalty maximum is £200. Now, you know, all the evidence we've got is that is nowhere near the level it needs to be a deterrent. In fact, you know, we got evidence from environmental health staff at councils that they would actually catch people in the act of fly tipping who would say, just give us the £200 fine, because it's cheaper for us to pay that than it would be to legally dispose of this stuff. So do you think this bill could be amended at stage two or three to try and address the items that I've referred to, and is that something you would welcome? Anyone?
With regard to the fines, I mean, I was waiting to see if somebody else would jump in. I'm trying not to hog the mic. I gave you the example from Highland Council. That was after the fines were increased. But they just don't have the capacity, and they're not doing it. And even when they've given an FPN, if there's not non-payment of it, then they're not following it up in actually a majority of the cases. I also have concerns, and this is more about the fixed penalty notices talked about in the bill rather than the ones that you're talking about, there's a risk they'll be disproportionately applied to people who are on lower incomes or with chaotic lifestyles or don't have English as their first language or live in areas where provision is worse. And there's another risk, which is that they won't get used at all. So our friends at Keep Wales Tidy have been in contact with Swansea Council, who have brought in these fixed penalty notices around household waste. And just this month, they said that since 2019, they've issued two of them. So I believe it was the first place in Wales to adopt this. And instead, they're sending out a sort of, you know, a traffic light system, a kind of, you know, please do better, really strongly please do better, honestly now. but that has still led to two fines. And I really think that systemic changes that provide more of a carrot to do the right thing, where the stick isn't on the member of the public who didn't really have any say in how that was devised. I mean, Michael's example of persistent organic pollutant is a really good one. You didn't know that when you didn't know you're buying some toxic waste. You thought you were buying a couch. Now it's your problem to deal with this really complicated thing. It should be the producer's problem. They need to be coming and collecting it. And as soon as that's the case, you remove a lot of the incentives. You know, why would you pay somebody with a van to take it away when you're going to get when you're going to get it collected for nothing by the producer, you know it's going to be handled properly. So I feel like there's a room for enforcement once all those things have been done to kind of catch what remains, people who are particularly lazy, irresponsible. But I think that's quite a minority. I think for most people, they just find themselves in a quandary and stuck in a system that's not designed to help them get their stuff back.
I mean, just on your point about people struggling to pay the fines, but one of the things we did find when we did some research was that increasingly organised crime is available in collecting, particularly industrial waste, and dumping it, because, as you fairly said earlier, it's a crime that is very hard to detect. Therefore, the chances of being caught are very low. And if you are caught, the penalties are so low that it's not a risk. And therefore, you know, the issue around increasing the fines, I think, is more to catch those people rather than just the householder who gets rid of a mattress in the wrong place.
No, I think that's right. And that, I mean, in a way, that's absolutely consistent with my argument about internalising their costs, right? That's just a business which has decided it can make some more money by just chucking it in the Tay, which is, or getting someone else to do it. And at that level, then fines are really the only way to internalise those costs onto them.
Yeah.
And then, really, you're going to have to spend a lot of time and effort on enforcement and pursuing that. But no, that I would fully agree with you there.
Yeah. Thank you. Phoebe.
Oh, yeah. Well, just quickly on the data side. Sorry, I'm not very familiar with your consultation, so I'm not sure exactly what type of data it was regarding. But the provision in the bill for reporting on waste and surplus, could that be somehow expanded, or would that indeed cover what you're thinking of as it is, or could it be modified to do that?
Yes, I'm sure it could. So one of the confusions is, at the moment, there are too many different bodies involved in collecting data. We have a role for local authorities, we have a role for SEPA, we have a role for Zero Waste Scotland. And my intention was to look at how we might create a duty on Scottish ministers to properly collect and publish and report on data, so there'd be a single collection point. It is something that's covered on page 8 of the fly tipping strategy, but it doesn't appear in the bill, which is why I thought it might be something that could usefully be put in the bill. And I'm very, interested in looking at amendments to the bill that would bring that in.
So, while you're sat there, we have people nodding their heads. Do you think it would be useful, just for the official record, for the government to collate data on waste tipping, fly tipping? Do you think that would be useful, or do you think it's happy with all the other organisations at the moment?
I was nodding understanding, not disagreement. I mean, it's just not my area of expertise. Okay. I think you would get some good answers from, like, Keep Scotland Beautiful as an organisation, or actually maybe the local authorities, who I believe you're seeing next week.
Okay, Murdo, one further one, and then I'm going to have to go.
No, to be honest, I think I'm done, unless any of the panel have anything they want to come back on. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Murdo. Monica, you wanted to come in, I think.
Yeah, thank you. And clearly there's an opportunity for members' bills to complement the circular economy. So good luck to Murdo Fraser. And I think colleagues are aware of my interest in ecocide prevention. But we've talked about small-scale fly tipping. We all, as MSPs, know the impact in our own communities. But as Murdo Fraser was saying, the major challenge is those organised crime gangs. I've referred back to the disclosure programme on the BBC, which I think we mentioned over a year ago to the previous Cabinet Secretary, Michael Matheson, where thousands of tonnes of waste is being illegally buried across Scotland right now. And even just, I think, a few weeks ago, SEPA put out a press release about the scourge of illegal end-of-life vehicle sites. And they believe there's over 100 unauthorised ELV sites across Scotland, hidden in plain sight. So we all know the impact. But from looking back at the disclosure programme, where one insider to a criminal network told the programme that waste was the new drugs, and these waste gangs are also involved in moving around drugs and weapons, other illegal items. And SEPA know about this, made it a priority along with these ELV, but don't seem to have the resource to really do anything meaningful about it. So going back to Circular Economy Bill, you know, are you concerned that CEPA and other regulators will have the resource and capacity to actually do anything? Because the scale of what we're hearing is an emergency. You know, where do they have a litter and fly tip and emergency declared? CEPA are clearly very concerned, but don't seem able to really do anything about it. So is that a concern that you shared? And maybe start with Kim.
So this is not my area of expertise, but on a very high level, my understanding is the same as yours, in that CEPA do not have the resources it needs to carry out its duties.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Sorry to jump in. It relates to a point that Mr. Fraser made, that there are a number, so many different bodies that might be responsible for it, and it's a subject where gathering data is very difficult, where enforcement is tricky. You haven't talked about a police role. It's like so many things. If you are going to have effective regulations, then you need to have ability to keep track of when they're being broken. You know, I often think that's forgotten about in a number of environmental policy areas. You kind of legislate some good intentions and then the implementation gets lost in a kind of guddle between various levels of government and NDPBs and all the rest of it. So I suppose my kind of optimistic hope is that some of that might get addressed through the vision document that I mentioned earlier, that will come out once this... I believe it will come out while this bill is still under consideration, so that... That might be a good source for some questions.
Yeah. I should say, looking at CEPA's recent release, they talk about the role for Scotland Serious Organised Crime Task Force, the Joint Unit for Waste Crime, the latter I don't really know that much about, but I think it's interesting for the public because there's been a lot of discussion about the individual behaviour changes and possible sanctions and sticks against individuals, but at the same time, on a national level, an international level, we've got these, you know, gangs that are operating, causing havoc in all our communities, destroying the environment, and no one's really going after them in a way that we need. But that's where you sometimes get pushback from the public if they feel that we're going after the individuals rather than the big
gangs. I think it's something the committee can reflect on in our stage one report, and whether there's too many organisations and whether it ought to be streamlined, and the collection of data. I think that's all valuable points. Bob, very briefly, and then I'm going to go to the deputy convener because I am now up against the clock, and the clock always wins. I can't stop it.
Convener, Bob. Convener, it will be very briefly. Witnesses may not need to respond, but I think I should put on the record in relation to a hugely serious fire in my constituency at the former Promat factory, which was industrial, commercial, illegal fly tipping on a site over a prolonged period of time. I can't say too much more about it, but CEPA are clear they need additional enforcement powers, and this is my first day on this committee, as you see, to witnesses in the convener, but this is maybe something I would want to look at as this bill progresses as well. But given my constituents' interest on that, I just want to put that on the record, convener.
Thank you, Bob. Deputy convener, I think you've got a question.
Thank you, convener. Yes, just to try and, as we move towards conclusion, I just wondered if you could comment on what are the most problematic waste streams in your view that should be subject to waste or surplus reporting, and what criteria should Scottish ministers apply when deciding what waste streams to prioritise for such reporting? Mr. Cook?
There's different forms of problematic, but I would highlight carbon impact, as in a tonne of waste is not equal to another tonne of waste, and for that I would say textiles, clothes, is quite high up on the list in terms of its material. Its tonnage may not be that high, but the carbon impact is much higher. Can't remember the stats, but I could email them into the committee afterwards. I think the other form of problematic is doing the right thing is difficult. Disproportionately difficult. And we have a system that more biases to doing the wrong thing, behaviourally speaking. So, I mean, I think single-use vapes are getting a lot of publicity at the moment. I think there's another committee looking at that even today. But, you know, it's estimated in Britain alone that single-use vapes, and that this isn't including the non-single-use vapes that are maybe treated as single-use vapes, but in the batteries alone, the lithium, in a year that's thrown away is enough to create 5,000 electric car batteries. So that's a circular, that's a loop I'd like to close, because, you know, take that lithium and use it, because we need, you know, lithium is a really rare resource. So I think the two criteria I would set you are carbon impact, CO2 impact, emissions, and secondly, rare materials that we really, you know, there's conflict abroad on our behalf to get those materials. You know, they should be top of the shopping list to close the loops there.
Thank you. That was very helpful. Any other? Yes?
Just very quickly, I wouldn't disagree with what Michael has said. I mean, if you look at the life cycle analysis impact of a product group or something, that should tell you, you know, the environmental impact that product, the manufacturer and disposable of it, will have on the environment. So, I mean, we've mentioned food and the carbon associated with that, and textiles, electronics come out quite highly because of the processes involved in manufacturing them and acquiring the minerals and metals in them. And then plastic, obviously, is a stream that we need to focus on because it's harmful in the environment. It doesn't break down, and it's obviously a fossil material.
Yeah. Thanks for that also. I'll go to Kim Pratt and then James McKenzie.
Just to add to that list, obviously textiles, plastic from a carbon point of view are very important. Also chemicals as well. We have a big chemical industry in Scotland, and there's a high carbon impact associated with their production. In terms of what are sometimes called critical minerals or transition minerals that we'll need in Scotland in order to move away from fossil fuels. The UK have a list of, I think it's about 18 minerals that will be needed to create a sustainable future. So that is something that I would recommend that the committee consider.
Thank you. And Mr. McKenzie?
Thank you. In terms of the priority, I think, from our perspective, I agree with all of that. You'll be unsurprised to hear. But I'd be looking for a kind of triple alignment here. I would like to see those priority items that my colleagues have talked about being the ones that are reported on, and also those being the ones where action is either being taken or being considered. So there's a bit of a perception that the environmental movement just wants to put endless costs onto business just for fun, and I can assure you that's not the case. If there's a sector or product category that ministers have definitively ruled out acting on, then there's no point gathering the data on it. It's only worth gathering the data if you're either building the case for what would be an effective intervention that would help build circular economy practices, bring those economic opportunities, bring those environmental benefits, or where you've already done one and you want to know if it's working, or whether people are complying with it. So I think there's a bit of a risk here that the Scottish Government will end up recommending reporting across a variety of sectors where they don't intend to act, and that, I'm afraid to say, is just a business cost for no purpose.
Thanks for all the contributions. Could I just ask one question? Because a single-use plastic that's not come up today or in our deliberations thus far on this bill is that of Nurdles. And certainly in coastal communities, particularly where there's extensive shipping activity and industry, including my own, the plastic pollution from Nurdles on our beaches is quite significant. And if there's anything you wanted to feed in about that matter, either now quickly or in writing thereafter, I'd certainly be interested to see it.
I'm going to jump in there because I'm sure you'll all want to contribute something to that comment, and we are just up against it on the clock. I really apologise. And I had a further question, which I'm sure I would encourage you to respond in writing to the clerks, is that we've had a lot of very useful discussions today. We've covered a huge area of subjects, but there may be something that we've missed that you want to see in the bill. If you haven't put it in your evidence, could I urge you just to write to the clerks when you're writing about the question the deputy convener raised about waste at sea, and put that in so we can consider it. I personally would like to thank you all for being very fleet of foot around the subject. You've answered lots of different questions very, very persuasively in some cases. And I would normally have suspended the meeting to allow you to depart, but because we are so up against it, I would ask if you could accept our thanks and quietly leave the room while we continue in public session with the issue that we've got to deal with next. So thank you very much. The next item is consideration of a Type 1 consent notification for the heavy goods vehicles charging for the use of certain infrastructure on Trans-European Road Revocation and Consequential Amendments Regulations 2023. That's a snappy title. This is a proposed UK statutory instrument where the UK government is seeking the Scottish Government's consent to legislate in an area of devolved confidence. On the 18th of October, the Minister of Transport notified the committee of the UKSI. The committee's role is to decide whether it agrees with the Scottish Government's proposal to consent to the UK government making these regulations within devolved competence and in the manner that the UK government has indicated it wished to the Scottish government. If members are content for consent to be given, the committee will write to the Scottish government accordingly. In writing to the Scottish government, we have the option to pose questions or to ask to be kept up to date. If the committee is not content with the proposals, however, we can make a series of recommendations. I mean, before I say what those recommendations are, I would ask if any member of the committee has any views on this, which they'd like to express. I'm not seeing any views. So my question is, are you content? The substantive question is the committee content that the provision set out in the notification should be made in proportion to the UK statutory instrument? We are agreed. Thank you. We will write to the Scottish Government to that effect. That concludes our public meeting, and we will now go into private session.